together, amen, in brotherly love. Indeed, we are happy. Well, we have a new norm now. As you guys can see, we try nothing with this streaming thing. So we would like to upgrade sometime in the future. So if you all think that it is good and you would like to contribute to upgrading, you can talk to the elders, right? So that we can have better equipment, so that we can look a little bit more professional. Not to say that we are not. It's the new norm. We either step up and continue moving forward, or stay the way we are, and we could maybe end up in a backward direction. While the opportunity is given for us to take this message into homes that may not necessarily welcome us or welcome some of us, they would gladly still log on and take part. So welcome once again to Sabbath School, to Sabbath Day's worship, to church. I trust that our week was filled. We would have taken part in different ways of having the message being brought to us, and God has been good to us through the Beatitudes. Amen? At this point in time, I would like now to ask us to please stand so that we can have a word of prayer. Let us pray. O Heavenly God and Eternal Father, indeed, Almighty God, you would have been gracious unto us. In spite of the fact that there is a pandemic going on in our world today, I think I can safely say that with maybe just one member or one family would have been affected, or let me just say would have been infected but not affected. You would have been good, you would have brought them through, you would have brought us through as a family, and we would have seen God work on behalf of us. So I pray, I give you thanks this morning for being so kind to us, for allowing us to see yet another Sabbath, to bask in your presence, to share in what you have in store for us. I pray and I ask that today be no different, that you use every man, every woman, every boy, and every girl that you would have equipped to carry your message to this world that is dying slowly. Save us into your kingdom, I pray, O God, through your message in word, in song, or a prayer. Cover us until such time you have used us up, that you decide to put us to rest. I ask that we will be able to say, like many servants who would have gone before us, that we would have done our part and done it faithfully unto our God. Take charge and take full control over today, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. At this time, Brother Kevin will now lead us out in song.
Pleasant morning to one and all. We'll turn to song number 109, Marvelous Grace, 109. Marvelous grace of our loving Lord, grace that exceeds all sin and all guilt. Yonder on Calvary's mount outpoured, there where the blood of the Lamb was spilled. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sin. Sin and despair like a sea wave cool, threaten the soul with infinite love, grace that is greater, yes, great unto, points to the refuge, the mighty cross. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sin. Marvelous, infinite, matchless grace, freely bestowed on all who believe. You that are longing to see his face, would you this moment his grace receive? Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sin. Give me the Bible, song number 272. 272. Give me the Bible, star of gladness gleaming, to cheer the wanderer alone and tempest tossed. No storm can hide that peaceful radiance beaming, since Jesus came to seek and save the lost. Give me the Bible, holy message shining, thy light shall guide me in the narrow way. Precepts and promise, lore and love combining, till night shall vanish in eternal day. Give me the Bible when my heart is broken, when sin and grief has filled my soul with fear. Give me the precious words by Jesus spoken, holds up his lamp to show my Savior's near. Give me the Bible, holy message shining, thy light shall guide me in the narrow way. Precepts and promise, lore and love combining, till night shall vanish in eternal day. And give me the Bible, all my steps enlighten, teach me the dangers of these realms below. That lamp of safety, oh, the gloom shall brighten, that lamp alone the path of peace can show. Give me the Bible, holy message shining, thy light shall guide me in the narrow way. Precepts and promise, lore and love combining, till light shall vanish in eternal day.
Amen. All right. At this time, we will be having our lesson study. We will be doing it on a whole, lesson 4, the hard way. I will be focusing in the book of Isaiah this quarter. So if you want to follow along, you can turn to Isaiah 7 and 8 is where the discussion will be taking place today. Amen? The memory verse is taken from Isaiah 8:17, and it says, I will wait on the Lord, who hides his face from the house of Jacob, and I will hope in him. Let's pray. All God and eternal Father, we go into your word now. I ask that you speak to us and teach us something today so that we can take home and impress our hearts so heavy that we will be willing to put it into practice. Thank you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. I will wait on the Lord, who hides his face from the house of Jacob, and I will hope in him. That's the memory verse for today. The story on the Sabbath speaks of a girl who was blind. And she was in a building on the fourth floor that was on fire. The story says that the firemen were wondering how they would be able to get her out of this building, knowing that she cannot see. And so because of where the building was, they were unable to get a fire truck in between the buildings to get a ladder up to her. Then came her father, who gave her some instructions, and the young lady followed. So the father asked her to jump out of the building, even though she could not see. She followed those directions and jumped out of the building, and her life was saved. If we were to take that story and we were to apply it to today, as if we were to put it to God, some things that God would have asked us to do, it would seem as though we are unable to see it. It's almost as if we are blind. We cannot see what it is. But because this young lady knew her father and she knew her father's voice, she obeyed. So the call is, do you know your father's voice? God, that is? Are you willing to jump if he asks you to? Are you willing to run if he asks you to? I don't know about you, but I would definitely like to do whatever he asks me to, because I know that his thoughts towards me is not to harm me, but to prosper me. He has an expected end for all of us. On Sunday, it talks about a fulfilling of a prophecy. Let me see the hands of all those who studied. All those who studied this week. Sister Anne Marie, Brother Philip, JP. Who else? Not much? All right. So, Brother Philip, so I will ask this question then. Even though you didn't study, and I pray that those who did would help us. Think. If you were living in the Northern Kingdom, while all this happened, how easy would it be to lose faith? How easy would it be to lose faith? A prophecy was being fulfilled. There, it had Israel being taken into captivity. Ahaz was the king, and he teamed up with the Assyrians, hoping that the Assyrians would help him. But the Assyrians didn't. So they were destroyed. If you were living in that time, knowing that your leader, let's say I am your leader, and I teamed up with somebody else, hoping that they will help us, and that didn't happen, what would your reaction be towards me as your leader? How would you feel? How would you react? You will feel disappointed? Uh-huh. Right.
Would go well, but he didn't.
Right. So his first mistake was not to take advice from God, but to take advice from men, not even just men, it seems, but men who were not even influenced by God. Yeah. Amen? And so destruction followed. And that destruction destroyed them. Moving over to Monday now, it says, I will do only the parts in the bottom of each day. All right? So our natural tendency is to trust in what we can see, feel, taste, touch, the things of this world. Yet, as we know, the things of this world will vanish. So why do we put our trust in things that will vanish, things that will disappear? That is a big question. Do we know?
Let me just make a point here. Mm-hmm. God has asked of us to trust him.
Yeah.
And it has been the theme of the Bible from a long time ago. From day one then. If you look at the situation with Adam and Eve, God had given them instruction. And he in the instruction, he told them, do exactly as I ask of you to do. And all will go well. And we all know that today, once we do what God has asked of us to do, everything will go well. For an example, if you have an appliance from the manufacturers will give you a book or a handbook concerning the operation of this
equipment.
Item yeah. or equipment. And if you fail to do what they ask of you to do in the manual, then what would happen? You may lose your life. You may burn down your house. And you will become a total wreck.
Mm-hmm.
But if you follow instructions, then all will go well and you would smile.
Yes.
So that's one of the examples. So I think when God says to do something, God knows the end results. You might not know the end result, but God, the creator of the heavens and the earth, he's the one who is saying it. And I think we ought to just follow along.
It seems as though... We reach to a place whereby we put our trust in the things that the blesser give, or the blessings, and not the blesser himself. Right? We no longer, so God is now like this gimme kinda thing. Like an ATM. Yeah, God is like an ATM. But here it is. We cannot withdraw from God what we didn't put in. So even though he's like an ATM card, and the ATM machine is there, you could always plug in and withdraw. But unless you deposit into, we won't be able to withdraw. Yeah. If you could love someone, touching, trusting. Question, brethren. Can we love someone without trusting them? What is your take? Is that possible? Love me. I love you, but I don't trust you. Saying somebody?
Love them at first sight.
Uh-huh.
You didn't test for trust, but you love them at first sight. And we normally fall prey to that as human beings.
Okay, but how do we apply that to Jesus? Jesus already loved us up front without even trusting us. Think about it. Or does Jesus trust us enough that he already put himself up? Hey, look, brother Nimrod, boy. Brother Nimrod, how are you going? You all right? You're trying to hide, but... Can't hide. I know them eyes, even though they're behind glasses. All right? And welcome to Sabbath School today. Yeah. So God would have trusted us, would have given his love to us. So how do we apply that? How do we apply that? Yes, God loved us. Yes, he loved us. He gave himself for us, in spite of the fact that we still have to grow into him. And if we fall in love with God, because trust is not something that comes instant. It takes time, because we are all humans. We will all make mistakes at some point in time. So to say that I don't trust you, but I love you, I don't know how possible that is. Because to love, to say that I love you, that is a trust by itself. To entrust you with my love. Hey, something or another there. It will work.
Yeah, once you leave the video, don't throw in the towel and complain about everything.
Right.
Right? Because we all make mistakes, as you said.
Yeah.
We all make mistakes. But you don't give up because of one particular mistake.
Uh-huh.
You continue the relationship and try to work with the situation.
And as God is the all-knowing God, God knows the end results. And this is why he asks us to trust him. And even though we don't understand all that we may learn about God and from God, it is still important to trust him. If we just throw in the towel, as they say, then we get nowhere.
Yeah, because despite repeated mistakes on the part of God's professed people, he still loved them. He still delivered them. And he will still deliver us. Amen?
Amen.
Nothing to fear. When we fear God himself, there's absolutely nothing to fear. Amen? Even in trusting. So if there's an individual that you might be interested in, the first thing you probably need to do is go to God in prayer. Yeah? Tell God about your problem. Tell God, say, Father, here we're going on. I see this nice darky down the road, and I really like this deal. Or, Father, I see that real nice red man down the road, and I really like you. So, I really like him, sorry. I really like him, but hey what, I need your approval. Let me know if this is the way to go. And if God says no, accept and say, brother or sister, it was nice to be nice, but not to continue. Amen? Now, Thursday was kind of interesting. I find it to be very, very interesting. And so we will go there. We have like about 5 more minutes. So we would spend our little 5 minutes on Thursday. Gloom of the ungrateful living dead. How possible is that? Living dead. Gloom of the ungrateful living dead. Can a man be dead while living? Living dead, spiritually, emotionally, what else? He's dead. Ahaz was one such guy. He was dead while he was alive, spiritually, because this guy left his religion to follow our next religion. Yeah? The man leave knowing who God is, worshiping God, to go and worship something that looks like a God. Has ears but cannot hear, hands and feet that cannot move. This guy, that's what this guy turned to. He was, the lesson says, the man was deeply involved in pagan religion, which was heavily interconnected with occult. The sacrifice to demons. Who? Occult? Occult, right. Thank you very much. Occult. Which was sacrifice to demons. Various aspects of modern witchcraft having taken parallels in ancient Near East rituals. Isaiah's description of despair result from reliance on spirits other than the Lord. Have you ever found yourself in any position like this? Whereby you're thinking that
Somebody doing something, you know. Do you think that possible? Do you think that these spirits are still around today? What? Like all your encounters?
Yeah, brethren.
Okay.
By concerning this question, right? I can remember when we was living in Mova, and we was getting a lot of break-ins into our house. Now, this, my side of family, on my mother's side, them is stunned Baptist.
Baptist.
Like, well, Baptist, Orisha, the full works, right? And, you know, one of my mom told me, she said, let me come and do my thing by your house.
All right.
Right? She said, oh, you know, when the fellas come in, they will not be able to come out until the police come. Right, I told her, I think, and I said, I said, mommy, we, as a Seventh-day Adventist, we ain't believe in that. Right, I mean, it have evil around. And what is going on with that is that evil, to conquer the evil, you have to do another piece of evil to conquer that evil.
Right.
Right, that's basically it. Right, and we said no. Right, and after that, we get break-ins again. You know, and after the devil started playing my mind, he said, boy, you know, if I only think that, but I said, no, let me, the Lord work it out such a way that I get peace of land in Talparo, I think I'm going to move out. So God does see the future, that thing. So all we need to do is trust him. And,
yes.
And as a people, especially Seventh-day Adventist people, it have a lot of us, maybe you all, even Tobago, they're Seventh-day Adventist, but they're dealing up with that thing. And we, no matter what burden, we had to trust God. Because in my situation, even with the court matter, things, people came to tell, as I tell you, I have plenty of family who is on our side, Baptist and Orisha and them, right? And I told them, nah, I trust in God. So that is what we need to do. No matter what the situation, it's have evil out there. But we don't need to do evil to conquer evil. Because that's what the devil wants us to do. Do evil to conquer evil. You got to do good. And then and God timing is never our timing. He work out everything in his own timing.
Amen, amen. Separation from occult is a matter of loyalty to God. Amen? Saul died because of his unfaithfulness. He was unfaithful to the Lord in that he did not keep the command of the Lord. Moreover, he had consulted a medium seeking guidance and did not seek guidance of the Lord. Therefore, the Lord put him to death and turn the king over to David's son, the son of Jesse. Same way, brethren, we might not go to the witchcraft doctor, but some of us, we stop listening to Seminary Adventist gospel message being preached, and we start to take in them other denomination message. Yeah? So slowly but surely, we drift in. We like a piece of pebble, a bottle or something out on the ocean. We start off by the shore, the water pick us up, and slowly the tide just keep carrying us. And one day, we would end up in a land that we never knew. May God help us that we do not have to find him in a hard way. May God help us that he does not have to treat us in a rough way in order to bring us back. We have a privilege, and that is to partake in this gospel message today, now, here and now. Let us make the best use of it. Let us not wait until we become an elder, a head deacon, a deaconess, a Sabbath school superintendent, to live exemplary lives, to do something for Jesus. The life we live is going to be and can be the best sermon that will ever be preached. Right? So let us live. Take Jesus in our lives each day, one day at a time, the songwriter says, sweet Jesus. That's all I'm asking from you. Let's take him at his word, for he will never leave us nor forsake us. That's his promise. And if you ever feel as though you've been forsaken, remind him of that text. You said, Lord, that you will never leave me nor forsake me. So why do I feel forsaken? Why do I feel as though I'm alone in this world? And you said that you are here for me. We are not alone. We would not have gone through this alone. There are others who are suffering too. All right, so let us continue to pray for each other and allow God to use us. At this time, we will have our announcements followed by a song service. And while the song service is being done, we will have the offertory being picked up. Amen?
Happy Sabbath, everyone. These are our announcements for today. All heads of departments are reminded to submit their plans, projections, and budgets for 2021 by February the 6th. In church, AY resumes Sabbath January 30th. Come and be blessed. The Personal Ministries Department is kindly asking for a contribution from members for an upcoming bread distribution on February 20th. Members, you will receive a chit after the service. We thank you in advance for your donation. On February 14, the Personal Ministries Department will be hosting a Grand Market Day. They are kindly asking members to submit the names of needy persons to them by Sabbath 6th of February so that special arrangements can be made for these persons. Names can be given to Brother Isaiah, Brother Brian, or Sister Joan. And our last announcement, all board members, please take note that there's an emergency meeting immediately after the service this morning. Our quote for the week, live life, make a difference, touch one heart, encourage one mind, inspire a soul. Do have a blessed Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. While Kevin is coming, I just want to take the opportunity to welcome everyone to church this morning. But in a special way, I want to thank Brother Adams for leading out in the week. And he did an excellent job. I've learned in life to appreciate people while they're alive. Somebody died in my life and it had many things I wanted to tell them, but I didn't tell them. So always in life, folks, appreciate people while they're alive. So I want to thank all the elders for their support in the week. I want to thank the members for coming out as well. And as we continue to worship our Heavenly Father, you know, let us lift our minds heavenward. Let's be joyful that we have life, because God is indeed a good God. You know, sometimes when I look at people's faces, it doesn't tell a good narrative, but God is good. We could always look upon his lovely face and be inspired to move on. So I just want to thank everyone for being here, and let's continue to serve God. We're not here to serve man, but we're just here to serve one person, our Heavenly Father. Amen.
Okay, we'll continue singing song number 474. 474, take the name of Jesus with you. Take the name of Jesus with you, child of sorrow and of woe. It will joy and comfort give you. Take it then wherever you go. A precious name, oh how sweet. Hope of earth and joy of heaven, precious name, oh how sweet. Hope of earth and joy of heaven, take the name of Jesus ever. As she's from every snare. If temptation wrong you gather, breathe that holy name in prayer. Precious name, oh how sweet. Hope of earth and joy of heaven. Precious name, oh how sweet. Hope of earth and joy of heaven. Oh, the precious name of Jesus. How it thrills my soul with joy. When his loving arms receive us, and his songs of tongues employ. Precious name, oh how sweet. Hope of earth and joy of heaven. Precious name, oh how sweet. Hope of earth and joy of heaven. At the name of Jesus bowing, falling prostrate at his feet. King of kings in every crown name, when our journey is complete. And precious name, oh how sweet. Hope of earth and joy of heaven. Precious name, oh how sweet. Hope of earth and joy of heaven.
Morning folks, as we I'll do the morning prayer at this time. So I want us to get in a position of reverence. I would kneel. If you could kneel, kneel. If you can't, just bow your heads and close your eyes. Good morning, Father in heaven. We thank you for life. We thank you when all is, when our hearts are sad and gloomy, you can fill our hearts with your love. When we are being persecuted and being ill-treated, we pray, dear God, that you are shelter and our storm. We prayed like Dr. King as he had a dream, that you have placed a dream in our hearts. And as we come to church this morning, I pray that your Holy Spirit will dwell within our hearts, that you will forgive us where we would have sinned, dear Father, where we would have done wrong unto your most holy name. I pray in a special way, dear Father, that you will bring comfort and cheer to your people, the ones that are sad, that you will bring cheer and happiness to them. The ones that are ill and not in the best of health, I pray that you would go by their side and speak to their hearts and touch them and bring healing and restoration to them. Those of us or those people that are in anguish, I pray that you be with them, help them. And the ones that are facing times of guilt and emotional distress and mental anguish, I pray, Father, that you would speak to their hearts, that your spirit will bring comfort and that he will bring cheer. I pray now, dear God, that you will be with your people at this time. Help us, dear God, to see the need to draw nigh, to look to your lovely face. And help us to understand that we have one enemy, Satan. He is the greatest foe. I pray that we would not see our brother or sister as the enemy, but we would see Satan. And help us, dear God, to love each other in spite of our differences. Help us, dear Father. And I pray a special prayer and the offering. I pray that you would bless it and may it go towards the furtherance of your gospel. So continue to bless your people. Bless your leaders that we would lead aright and we would lead the people in righteousness to bring about revival and reformation in the lives of many and your church. So thank you, Father. Be with the one that I'm about to speak today. I pray that you would bless his heart, that he would proclaim the word,
to bring glory to your name. So continue to bless us and abide with us in Christ, we pray. Amen.
Okay, we'll turn to song number 246, Worthy, Worthy is the Lamb, 246.
Encourage everyone as we go through this life. We may have so much of problems and we want to take it into our own hands, but I just want to stop by to tell you, give it to God. He can solve all problems. Just trust and believe in Him.
There is no problems too big God cannot solve it. And there is no mountains too tall He cannot move it. There is no storm clouds too dark God cannot calm it. And there is no sorrow too deep He cannot soothe it. And if he carried the weight of the world upon his shoulders, and I know, my brother, that he will carry you. And if he carried the weight of the world upon his shoulders, and I know, my sister, that he will carry you. And he said, come unto me, all who are weary, and I will give you rest. There is no problem too big, God cannot solve it. And there is no mountains too tall, he cannot move it. And there is no storm clouds too dark, God cannot calm it. And there is no sorrow too deep, he cannot soothe it. But if he carries the weight of the world upon his shoulders, and I know, my brother, that he will carry you. And if he carries the weight of the world upon his shoulders, and I know, my sister, that he will carry you. He will carry you, and he will carry you.
Amen, amen. One day, one of these days, one of these days, yeah? One of these days, man. If not here, when I get to heaven, yeah? Yeah, man, I'm gonna dance too. Not just, not just that alone. I'll dance, yeah? I wanna see Miriam and David and the others. Yeah, man, at this point in time, our hearts will now be blessed with the word from no other than Elder Samuel Phillips.
Happy Sabbath, Bedjan. Indeed, we had a wonderful week this week. Amen. Indeed, there is no problem too big for God to solve. We can all agree. If we were to take a survey here right now, yes or no, it will be 100%. Yes, indeed. Today we want to end this week's Holy Spirit Emphasis Week with the last message. Blessing on the persecuted and slandered. Yes, blessing. How can it be a blessing to be persecuted? You know, the world may not understand this, but only the Christian can. Only the one who relies on Christ. Only the one whose life is in Christ can understand this. Let's close our eyes for prayer this morning. Heavenly Father, hide me behind your cross. You show forth yourself now, dear God, to your people. Speak to us. Lord, now we invite your Holy Spirit to abide in our hearts and in our minds. The world our cares, hide them. As we listen to your word today, may that be our focus now. And with the help of your Holy Spirit, Lord, we can indeed apply what we learned today into our lives. So take charge now of the proceedings. Remove all distractions, even for those listening online. Remove any distractions, Lord. Prevent any calls. Prevent anything, Lord, that would prevent them from having to move away from the screen from hearing your word. And may today's message inspire all of us to not to give up, but to live for you faithfully. Thank you, Lord, even now. In Jesus' name, amen. Have you ever reflected on the day you decided to become a Christian? Has any one of us ever did that? I have, many times. Can you remember the joy that filled your heart when you stepped out of the sea or the baptismal water? Do you recall having any concern that persecution might come your way? My friend, I wish I could promise you that your walk with Christ would be filled with nostalgia, or as the saying goes, let me read over that. Brethren, friends, I wish I could promise you that your walk with Christ would be filled with nostalgia, or as the saying goes, a bed of roses. On the contrary, I must caution you that most Christians, in an abstract sense, know that persecution is a part of the deal. Jesus promised that the Christian walk would be challenging. Yes, he promised. Yes, the way of the cross is the way of life. Putting together two contradictory ideas, death and life. Researchers at the Center of Global Study for Human Rights report that every 5 minutes a Christian dies for his faith in one or another part of the world. Every 5 minutes. And every year, more than 100,000 Christians die a violent death. It begs me to wonder if that is the reason why people are afraid to follow Christ. Yet the biblical mandate compels us to carry the word of God to every corner of the globe. Despite this, the question comes to us, should we witness in an area where our lives are at high risk for persecution? The biblical response is found in Matthew chapter 24, verse 14. And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come. The Bible does not lie. Who have to carry the gospel? Christ asked us, his disciples, to do so. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. This is our commission, brethren. Despite the persecution, the high risk of it, it must be carried forth. From the onset, Christians experience persecution. Our faith was founded, after all, on Jesus Christ, who was falsely accused, who experienced a sheer miscarriage of justice, who was wrongly imprisoned, and who wrongfully was executed. What did he do? Is seeking to save us, sinful sinners, a bad thing? But he did it for us, out of love. Amen? For the first few hundred years, Christians not only expected persecution, but they also embraced it. The beatitude, blessed are the persecuted, is three times longer than the others. And Jesus continued, blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice, rejoice, and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. Matthew 5:11-12. Blessing on the persecuted and slandered. Imagine for a moment receiving a visit from a church leader who offers you a church position and informs you that you would be tortured, ridiculed continuously, ignored, criticized, and slandered. Would you think such a calling came from Christ? Brethren, would you think such a calling came from Christ? Christ is all about positivity. Christ is about life. Christ is about blessings. The Apostle Paul in the book of Hebrews described a similar perspective shared by faithful members of the past who gladly followed and suffered for God. He states in Hebrews chapter 11 verses 35 to 38, others were tortured, refused to be released so that they might gain a better resurrection. Some faced jeers and flogging, while still others were chained and put in prison. They were stoned. They were sawed in two. They were put to death by the sword. They went about in sheepskins and goatskins, destitute, persecuted, and mistreated. The world was not worthy of them. Oh, in my sinful state, without Christ, this sounds like something to run from. Imagine you are there viewing your loved one being sawed in two. Being put to death by the sword with your own naked eye. I can't begin to imagine what would be our state to view such a thing. But if we are not in Christ, it's another story. But this is what these Christians faced. But brethren, the moral is clear. When an individual decides to follow Christ wholeheartedly, that decision will never be a calling for the faint of heart. The calling goes out to men and women of every age and descent to be courageous. I said to be courageous. And more specifically, to the members of the remnant, to run with patience the race that is set before us. as the Bible tells us in Hebrews 12, verse 1. Brethren, as Christ was hated without cause, so will his people be hated because they are obedient to the commandments of God. Despite our trials now, things are nice. That's why the constant call is to get ready, to be prepared for what is to come. Because what I just read here that took place with those Christians that were persecuted, it will be far worse. Not saying this to scare us, but it's urgent that we prepare ourselves. Otherwise, we will choose the other side without even thinking about it. In Maranatha, page 195, Ellen White tells us, as Christ was hated without cause, so will his people be hated because they are obedient to the commandments of God. If he who was pure, holy, and undefiled, who did good and only good in our world, was treated as a base criminal and condemned to death, his disciples must expect but similar treatment. However faultless may be their lives and blameless their character, we must expect this. It is coming. And our current trials are preparing us for this. Blessing on the persecuted and slandered. As you listen in the conversation on the hillside in Judea with Jesus, his disciples, and the multitude in Matthew chapter 5, as you listen to it, you would realize that it's not a divine to-do list. Neither is it a list of commandments. Instead, it is a descriptive pronouncement from heaven's vantage point, offering hope to present human realities that his hearers were experiencing in their lives. The meek, the peacemaker, the hungry, the merciful, the mourning, and yes, even the persecuted are all considered blessed by God. I could fall asleep, boy. I'll read that again. The meek, the peacemaker, the hungry and thirsty, the merciful, the mourning, and yes, even the persecuted are all considered blessed by God. Amen. Yes. Christ is saying in this discourse that those who are persecuted because of their relationship with him are truly blessed. Yes. Christ's followers today who are consistent with the experience of the faith of faith's heroes recorded in sacred history in Hebrews chapter 11 will be called to endure physical, emotional, and spiritual distress in their quest to honor God and his kingdom. Yet most ironically, for their trials and troubles, understand that temporal and most certainly eternal blessings are guaranteed. Amen. Those who suffer persecution today are not the first and won't be the last. But they can take comfort in knowing that they are not alone in their sufferings. Yes, brethren, we are not alone. And come what may, we are not alone. We are connected to a great cloud of witnesses. Persecution for the sake of the gospel of Jesus is for all of us. Yes, it's for all of us. Whether these believers are in intense waves, as in the areas of Islamic tension, civil unrest, political upheavals seen in many countries around the world today, or in the pitiful, painful, broken relationship, they are associated with being a Christian in a secularized Western society. Persecution for the believer is also associated with members of the Seventh-day Adventist Church who refuse to work on the Sabbath. Amen. A stance that may appear to restrict their career opportunities or prospects for promotion. Christians do not choose the battles through which they would receive blessings. Rather, it is a divine perspective that moves by unseen hands that brings the believer to his time of trials and persecution intended to perfect him for blessings and honor. Yes, for those of us where we would have faced situations like this, having to get the time off on Sabbaths, we can all testify that God came through for us. Amen. Amen? And this is small compared to the other things we might have faced in our lives. What God provides, God sees us through, come what may. Come what may. Let's not be like the Israelites. Look at what they went through. Seeing God's mighty hand at work, time and time again. And when things going nice, it's like God wasn't in the picture. I pray that that is not our faith. I pray that that is not how we operate. As a people, we must learn to praise God through all the changing scenes of life. We can praise Him for increased paychecks, scores of baptisms, a new home, or health restoration. But brethren, let's not neglect to praise Him for cancer. Yes, I said it. Let's not neglect to praise Him for the knee pain, for the back pain. Let's not neglect to praise Him for the car crash, for the foreclosure of lost career opportunities, or for not ensuring the employment opportunity by refusal to work on the Sabbath. Yes, in these situations, it is often hard to give God the glory. But when fully consecrated to God's will, no matter what we face, He will resolve everything to His glory. Amen? There is no escape, brethren, from the intense pressures and stress in this life. There's no running from it. But there is peace. Yes, there is peace. When we put God in the picture and keep Him there, there is peace. Yes. The Apostle Peter wrote to a group of suffering Christians with words of encouragement in 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse 10. This is what he said. After you have suffered for a little while, the God of all grace, who called you to His eternal glory in Christ, will Himself perfect, confirm, strengthen, and establish you. What a promise. Brethren, the suffering is temporary. In contrast and comparison to the eternal glory that is in store for us, believers of Christ. It is temporary when we compare it to eternity. The spending it in heaven with Christ, our Savior. It is only temporary. Today, my dear friends, we can rejoice to know that suffering is for a short time. Suffering is for a short time. But out of the suffering comes blessings that cannot be obtained by any other means. Ellen White states in the book Thoughts from the Mount of Blessings, page 29 and 30. As men seek to come into harmony with God, they will find that the offense of the cross has not ceased. Principalities and powers and wicked spirits in high places are arrayed against all who yield obedience to the law of heaven. Therefore, so far from causing grief, persecution should bring joy to the disciple of Christ. For it is evidence that they are following in the steps of their master. Amen. Persecution in our lives assures us that we are on the right path. If we are not going through anything, we need to check ourselves. This is what she just said there. We need to check ourselves. The Christian life is not a bed of roses. And Satan has his other side of it, where it is a bed of roses on his side. But on the side that wins in the end, my dear friends, it is not. So choose ye this day which side you are on. It may be hard to accept, but persecution for God reaps bounteous blessings. I'm not lying. The Bible said it. The word of truth said it. In Job chapter 23, verse 10, the Bible states, "But he knows the way I take. When he has tried me, I shall come forth as gold." I shall come forth as gold. Paul says in Philippians chapter 3, verse 8, "Yea, doubtless, and I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but dung, and do count them but dung, that I may win Christ." My dear friends, our cell phones, our fancy cars, our fancy homes should be worthless to us in comparison to having a relationship with Christ. Amen? God strengthens character in the fires of persecution. Yes, God strengthens character in the fires of pressure. This is what he does. "After you have suffered for a little while" indicates that blessings come only after we submit to the refiner's fire. We cannot disregard suffering, brethren. We cannot run from it. We cannot ask God to remove it from our lives. Lord, I can't take it no more. Let's take comfort in our sufferings. God will give us the grace to meet every situation in life. And we can all testify of that fact in the past situations. Can we? Yes. The standing invitation remains, brethren. Come unto me, all you that are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Come you who are persecuted for righteousness' sake. Come you who are weary, tired, hurting. Come you who are suffering for the cause of Christ. Come you who are ravaged by terrible disease. God gives us his strength to meet the demands of this life. He is the God of all grace, quickening grace, pardoning grace, cleansing grace, believing grace, sustaining grace, and sovereign grace. My dear friends, the God of all grace has a storehouse that never runs out. Out of that constant supply of saving and sanctifying grace, God does a marvelous work in us. And his goal is to perfect us. Amen? So the question is, are you ready to be perfected? Are you ready, brethren? Those online, are you ready to be perfected? The master indicates the place of the reward. Great is your reward in heaven. Only in the kingdom of heaven will the redeemed receive the reward that the Lord has prepared for them. So I appeal to us all this moment, regardless of your present circumstance or crisis, pressures or pain, sufferings or sorrow, failures or frustration, danger or disease, memories or misery, temptations or trials, problems or persecutions, burdens or brokenness, as you evaluate them all in your own life or in the world right around you, or even in your marriage or your family, meditate on this question. What is the Lord teaching you about himself? We feel because we are serving the Almighty God. How can this happen to me? It is unfair. I shouldn't be going through this. What is the Lord teaching us about himself? When things are hard and we want to give up, what is the Lord teaching us about himself? You may think that it's Satan trying to put a spoke in our walk with Christ. It might be so. But it's Christ at the same time working on perfecting us. Satan can try what he wants. But in every situation, God uses to perfect us. Satan's aim is to throw us off course, to bring us on him, on his side. But let's allow the persecution, the trial, or whatever it may be. Let's allow God to do its work in us to perfect us. Satan will continue to try. But we know whose side we are on, don't we? You know, we like to sing the chorus, Satan is a loser man. a loser man all the time. Do we believe that? Let's stay on the winning side. Brethren, let's remember that our situations are temporary compared to eternity. In the closing chapters of the final book of the Bible, God makes a beautiful promise to all of us in Revelation chapter 21 and verse 4. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There shall be no more death, no more sorrow, nor crying. There shall be no more pain, for the former things have passed away. Amen. I can't wait for that time. What about you, Benjamin? I cannot wait. But in the midst of our pain here on earth, we must never forget that earth is not our final destination. It is not. John chapter 14, verses 1 to 3. Jesus, our Redeemer, says to us in 2021, let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go, and prepare a place for you, I might come again. I might think about coming again. Did I read something wrong there? Oh, sorry. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again. Amen. Amen. And receive you unto myself. And there I am. And where I am, there ye may be also. Amen, brethren. This is our God. This is our Savior. This is the promise to us in 2021. Jesus is fed up of our long-distance relationship. And he's yearning for us to be there with him. He's yearning, brethren. Aren't you tired of this long-distance relationship? I mean it, free. We don't have to spend no money to call on our Savior, but I'm fed up. What about you? Let's stand and take our Bibles and turn to 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 12 to 19. And we are all going to read this text. 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 12 to 19. Yes, let's all stand. We are closing up. 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 12 to 19. And as you read this, let's meditate on it. It is not just words. It is how we should operate in these end times. For what is to come? The normal person out there will choose Satan's side without thinking about it. But we, God's children, followers of Christ, the Bible does not lie. And once we believe in him, these promises are guaranteed. It's not no buts or maybe or might. It is guaranteed. So 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 12 to 19. We all read after 4, 3, 4. Love it. think it not strange concerning the fiery trial, which is to try you as though some strange thing happened unto you. But rejoice in as much as ye are partakers of Christ's sufferings, that when his glory shall be revealed, ye may be glad also with exceeding joy. If ye be reproached for the name of Christ, happy are ye, for the Spirit of glory and of God resteth upon you. On their part, he is evil spoken of, but on your part, he is glorified. But let none of you suffer as a murderer, or as a thief, or as an evildoer, or as a busybody in the other man's matter. Yet, if any man suffer as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God on this behalf. For the time is come that judgment must begin at the house of God. And if it first begin at up, what shall the end be of them that obey not the gospel of God? And if the righteous scarcely be saved, what shall be the ungodly and the sinner appear? Wherefore, let them that suffer according to the will of God commit to the keeping of their souls to him in well-doing as unto a faithful Creator. Praise the Lord. There's no explanation needed. Today, brethren, we can rejoice and be exceeding glad. Today, we can count it all joy as we look beyond whatever trial, whatever persecution, to the eternal blessing that's in store for all of God's redeemed children. Yes, we can say without any doubts in our hearts today, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Is this your plea today, brethren? As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Amen. Blessings on the persecuted and slandered. It's all blessings for God's children. Blessings on the meek, blessings on the poor in spirit, blessings on they that hunger and thirst after righteousness, blessings on the merciful. It's all blessings. But Satan, our enemy, because of him, we are going to face persecutions. We are going to be slandered. But today, it is our plea that I will serve the Lord. Amen? Amen? At this time, we want to go into a prayer session. Individually, we want to ask God to help us to give way to the Holy Spirit, that when the fires come, we would not ask for them to be removed, but it can do its work in us, and in the process we can praise his name, we can find joy and rejoice in the fiery trials, great or small, knowing that as we suffer persecution for our Savior, we are blessed. This is our prayer focus now, individually. Let's do that at this time. believe everyone is finished. So, brethren, as we walk through the valleys of the shadow of death, let us fear no evil, because it's assured that the Lord will be with us. Amen? At this time, we will close with our theme song, hymn number 26. I think it's 264.
O for the flame of living fire. 264. Oh, for the flame of living fire, which shone so bright in saints of old, which bled the souls to help us fight, come in distress, in danger bold. Where is that spirit? Red Lord, with dwell in Abraham's rest and seal him down, with made poor's heart with sorrows melt and glow with energy divine. That spirit which from age to age proclaim thy love and taught thy ways, brighten as your violet page, and bred in David's hallowed. Is not thy grace as mighty now as when Elijah felt its power, when glory beamed from Moses' brow, all Job endured the trying all. Remember, Lord, the ancient days, renew thy word, thy grace restored, and while to thee our hearts we raise, on us thy Holy Spirit pour.
Let's pray. Oh, we give a thanks, Lord, for being in your house today. We want to thank you, Lord, for the message that you have sent to us today. Lord, as messages like these, Lord, help us, Lord, live good Christian life for you, good godly lives to you. Because your word tell us, you know, blessed are those who are persecuted. Lord, it may sound harsh, but your word also tell us that all that will live godly in Christ shall suffer persecution. Lord, this Christian walk is not an easy walk. May each and every one sit back and count the cost. See if it worthwhile suffering for you. See if it worthwhile being persecuted for you. See if it worthwhile for man might say evil things against us try to discourage us. Even worthwhile, O Lord, let us sit back and count the cost. If we look at all the men, all the godly men passed by before, Lord, watch what they go through. Watch what your disciples went through for you. Some was hung upside down, some head was cut off. Lord, let us sit down and count the cost. See if we want to suffer persecution for you. Lord, send your Holy Spirit, Lord, to work through our hearts at this time. Help us, Lord, as we reflect on your word, Lord Jesus, that we will purpose in our heart, no matter what may come our way, Lord, we will live godly lives to you. No matter what persecution come our way, whatever discouragement come our way, Lord, we will purpose in our heart to live for you. No matter what fire we go through, what water we go through, Lord Jesus, we will stay faithful to you, O God. Please help us, Lord, in our walk with thee. Lord, we want to hear the words when you come. Well done, good and faithful servant. Please do that for us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
All right, so as we go, don't forget, persecution for Christians is not a possibility, it's a promise. It is not a maybe, it is surely. Following Jesus can mean finding the trouble you are looking for. May God bless us and keep us all safe. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Carried out redemption's plan. You are